Guild Wars 2's Conditioned Weaver, an extremely fun class to play, favored by higher experienced players but loved by many. Let's have a look at why this class is just so damn good. For the positives, extremely good damage. Weaver classes and elementalists in general have a reputation of being glass cannon builds. Even though there is a lot of survivability built into them in recent updates, they still have such a reputation. Another positive is that most of this damage can be done at range, making it quite attractive to newer players, especially ones that want to play something good in fractals, raiding, but also want something for open world that they can dominate in. And another positive for me is that it's just such a fun class to play. I think that the mechanics behind Weaver and the way it plays is so interesting and unique compared to any other class in Guild Wars. And now for the negatives. With Elementalist and Weaver in general, it's always got a bit of a tougher rotation for newer players. Yes, the more experienced players are like, oh yeah, this is so easy, it's glossy and smooth. But for a newer player, it's so hard to remember, okay, this element to this, to this, to this. And that can be quite a big con for newer players because it feels like you're playing piano more than an actual class. And then probably the biggest negative for me is just the way that it plays in terms of utility and CC. You don't have access to instant skills, you have to pre-think about the fight, you go into those elements early, and therefore you have those skills ready. Which means that good fight knowledge is so paramount when playing Weaver, that if you are fairly inexperienced or if certain mechanics come up that you're not prepared for, you might not be able to react completely in time. Hey, I've been streaming on Twitch a bit, link above me, probably one in the description below. Been doing a couple of drops, jamming a bit of Guild Wars, some other games, and been, yeah, having a really good time. Love to see you there, stop by, help me hit my follower goal, and yeah. Anyway, back to the video. Now let's have a look at some gear and stats. For gear, we went pretty much everything Vipers with Trapper Runes. The Trapper Rune will help us get quite a bit of condition, damage, and duration, while the Viper's gear is going to give us a lot of damage, but also a bit of precision, which is quite important. Because for weapons, we've got pretty much two major options. Scepter in the main hand, and I recommend putting your Sigil of Torment in there. What this will do is basically give us some torment when we crit, which the high precision does help with. Then for your offhand, you can either go for a Warhorn or a Focus. Depending on the content and the gameplay style, both of these are fairly viable. For the Sigil in the offhand, Sigil of Earth is pretty good to have. And then for our Relic, we want Relic of the Fractal. Obviously, all of this build for now, although this might change with the PvE balance update that's coming in a week or two. And for food and utilities, you want something like the cured meat flatbreads. You just want something with condition damage as its main stat and expertise as its off stat. For utilities, you either want something like the toxic fusing crystals or icicles or something else like maybe the master and tuning crystals if you want a bit of a cheap option. Although the toxic fusing crystals are going to give you the best DPS. And now let's have a look at our traits and specializations. Our first specialization, fire. Minor trait 1, empowering flames, just 150 power when attuned to fire. Quite nice to know about. In column 1, burning precision is just too good not to take. What the skill does is it increases the duration by 20%, but notice that is towards the 100% cap, so it can't go above 100% burn duration, as well as when you crit, it can apply burning, but that is a 33% chance on crits. We do tend to have quite a bit of precision due to the fact that we have Signet of Fire, so that effect makes this quite a good trait. Now, I don't really see Conjurer as a good trait to take, but I do think Lesser Cleansing Fire can see some play. But the 40-second cooldown on the skill makes this so less attractive compared to burning precision. Now, Minor Trait 2 is ridiculously strong. Sunspot, basically getting fire aura when we attune to fire. Burning stacks extra damage as well as obviously having the fire aura itself. Now, in column 2, Burning Rage, Sunspot inflicts burning as its radius is increased, but most importantly, we gain 180 condition damage. Obviously, just pumping up our DPS in general. Sunspot is referring to Minor Trait 2, that's where the two stacks of burning is coming from, as well as the radius increase that you see in blue. Now, I do think for the open world, Smothering Auras has some sort of utility gameplay, but it doesn't really do anything for us, and Power Overwhelming is more towards your Power Weaver or Power Damage, which basically brings us back to Burning Rage is just the best choice in general. Minor Trait 3, pretty much similar for all Elementalist, Pyromancy Training, What usually the minus 33 of all these elements does is increase the damage and reduce the recharge of that specific element. In this case, fire increased damage and fire skills reduced recharge. Now in column 3, persisting flames is generally the best choice. 5 fields we create from weapon skills last 2 seconds longer. As well, when they hit foes, they basically stack this damage buff, and you can stack it up to 10 times, just affecting us with some good DPS. Now, Flame Expulsion seems like quite an interesting skill to use. I feel maybe for open world and like more of a supportive build, it will have its place, basically consuming 10 stacks or whatever stacks you have on you of might, and basically doing some big DPS as well as giving might to allies. It's an interesting skill, but basically losing might in any like high-end activity can be quite not great. Specialization number 2, Earth. Stone Flesh, your minor trait 1, strike damage reduced by 7%, so basically just increase survivability. Really good, especially if you're tanking. Now in column 2, Serrated Stones, basically just getting 5% increased damage and 20% increased duration on bleeds, which is pretty massive for our DPS overall. Your first choice, Earth's Embrace. When it turns into Earth, you're getting some barrier. This seems fairly good, especially if you are open world or you're tanking to some degree, but the DPS loss from Serrated Stones is just too massive not to have. And then the last choice, Elemental Shielding, gaining some protection when you grant auras to allies. Yes, this could be more supportive, but I feel like this is more like a Heal Tempest kind of trait to take. Minor trait 2, Earthen Blast. What this does is when it turns into Earth, you will cause some damage as well as cripple to 5 targets around you. Now just be aware of that, because sometimes in fights you don't want to cripple certain targets, or sometimes you do. So just make sure that you position correctly to either cripple or not cripple certain targets. In column 2, Strength of Stone, what this skill does is gives us condition damage based on toughness at 10%, which means it's about 100 condition damage. And notice that this is not affected by your rock barrier, which increases your toughness by 250. And notice that you also get 3 stacks of bleeding if you immobilize a foe, but this is delayed by 3 seconds. You can't just keep spamming some sort of immobilize. Rock Solid is an interesting choice. Getting a stack of stability when attuned to Earth, this could be pretty clutch in some fights, but I don't really see it being massive as a DPS play to take something like this. And then also Earthen Blessing. What this does is it allows chills, cripples, and immobs to last 33% less on you, and you gain 10 endurance if any of these conditions are put on you. I can see these being played in some open world events and stuff, especially if you're playing solo. But in a raid group or fractal group, I don't really see these being played too often. And then in column 3, Written in Stone. This skill is deceptively good. What this does is allows our signets to continue to give us their passives even when on recharge, as well as gaining an aura when used. Now that is pretty massive, because we have signets of fire, which increases our crit chance. Now remember, we do have things like the Sigil of Torment, and we have a few skills that rely on us to crit to get the most out of them. So that means that even when we use Signet of Fire to do some big DPS, we will keep that crit chance, helping us with our Sigil of Torment and a couple of other traits to keep on critting and doing some massive DPS. Now the other options in column 3 are Diamond Skin, basically removing a condition every 1 second if you're above 75% health, as well as Stone Heart. When entering and exiting Earth, you can't be crit hit for a short time, and basically those seem like more PvP. I could maybe see Diamond Skin being played to some degree, but because you're a DPS in the open world, even this is not very viable. And now for our elite specialization, Weaver. Minor trait 1, Weaver. Basically allowing your active atonement to be on your main hand and your old atonement to be on your off hand. Also giving you access to dual skills. So when you're combining between 2 skills, you have a brand new skill in your skill 3. Now in column 1, Superior Elements is generally the way most people go. What this does is allows dual attacks to give weakness when using them. As well, when we attack a weakened foe or a foe with weakness on it, whether it's from us or someone else, doesn't matter, we get 15% increased crit chance. So that helps us as basically a Condi class to not just get the bonus from Signet of Fire, but also the bonus from this skill to do some big DPS. Now, choice 2, Elemental Pursuit. This seems like quite a decent skill in open world. I can see it getting some play. 2.5 seconds isn't the worst thing in the world, but yeah, very niche application. But as a newer player, you could consider Master's Fortitude. What this does is will give us some vitality as well, extra vitality based on our power and condition. So this equates to almost about 2k vitality, which is fairly good if you are struggling with survivability. However, obviously it's a massive DPS loss not to take superior elements. But yeah, it just depends on your playstyle and your experience level. Mana Trait 2, Elemental Refreshment. Now, I really like the fact that they've kind of changed Weaver to have some sort of a supporting abilities. And you will see with the future PvE patch update, there is more that they'll bring into the table. But Elemental Refreshment, when using dual attacks, you'll give barrier not just to yourself, but to your party. And that's quite a decent amount of barrier as well. In column 2, Weaver's Prowess, what this trait does is it gives us increased condition damage as well as duration when swapping, and that's an 8 second duration. Your elements have a 4 second cooldown time, which means you will maintain this very easily, giving you some massive DPS as well as condi duration. In fact, with this skill alone and your traits and armor, you will be pretty much almost duration capped on most of your important condis. Other traits in column 2, Swift Revenge. When using a dual skill, you'll get swiftness as well. When you attack a target while you have swiftness, you'll gain increased strike damage. Now, this could be fairly good in the open world if you do require swiftness. Maybe you would like to move from place to place, or maybe you are just struggling with your swiftness uptime for some reason. This could be considered quite easily. And then obviously you've got bolstered elements. Now what this does is it allows you to gain barrier when you use any stance skill. So now these are basically the skills that you get from being a weaver. So your stance skills, you can see I get the 680 barrier. As well, if I do drop below 50% health, it will cost lesser stone resonance, so a big barrier as well. And this can be quite good in a lot of cases in the open world. Maybe in raids if you really are struggling, but the DPS that you will lose from Weaver's Prowess will be very, very substantial. So just take that into account. But remember, survivability and getting content done could be more important, especially for a newer player. Minor Trait 3, Elemental Polyphony. I think I've said that right, maybe. Basically, you just get extra stats when you're attuned to whatever element. But if you're attuned to two elements at the same time, i.e. like say Earth and Fire, I will get both the power and the vitality. So when you pure attune to fire, you will drop that vitality, but you'll gain it back when you get into your earthen state. Now in the final column, Elements Rage. This is a very, very important trait to be aware of. When you pure attune, i.e. fully attune towards one element, you will gain a damage increaser for 8 seconds. Now that's quite hardcore because it takes you 4 seconds to switch between elements. Now generally, and we'll get into this from the rotation concept, the idea is to go fire, earth, fire, fire, earth, you know, so you basically you go 2 fires, 1 earth. So you will pure attune to fire, so we will make use of this trait, but then to try and get back as quickly as possible. Because it only has an 8 second duration, that means that your rotation timing is tight if you want to play at the highest level. If you're a newer player, don't stress about it. If this drops off for a second or two, it's not the worst thing in the world. But if you want to be one of the better players, and i.e. some sweaty tryhard, your rotation timing is quite fine. Also, we gain precision based on vitality, and this is just free precision, which is making it really strong for a lot of those traits that required us to crit. Now, Woven Stride is quite interesting. We gain swiftness when we basically give a movement impairing effect to an enemy. That's obviously on a 3 second cooldown, but when we have swiftness or super speed, we gain regen, and swiftness is more effective, 20% more effective. So that's quite interesting for moving around really quickly. Maybe there is some cases where you will find this useful. And then Invigorating Strikes, when using dual attacks, we'll gain some vigor as well. Dodge rolling will give us a barrier. So this is just more survivability. Definitely something to consider in open world, or if you are soloing, having barrier as well as vigor is pretty massive. And that's pretty much our traits and specializations. You probably have noticed that there aren't really much choices. It's pretty much set in stone for now, and there are one or two things you can consider for some, maybe some barrier or survivability, but there's not really any choices in terms of like raiding of fractals. It's quite set in stone. Now let's have a look at utilities. For healing skills, we've got a few options. At the moment, Signet of Restoration is generally what most people take. You gain health every time you use an ability cast a spell. If you want to use the active skill, this will also give you a decent amount of healing as well as Frost Aura because of the traits we've taken. As well, remember that this skill is made even better because of Written in Stone. We will keep the passive effect even when using this heal skill, meaning that we'll always have that benefit of gaining health when casting abilities. So you can use this as often as you want to get maximum effect out of it. Now, obviously, things like Aether Renewal seem very good. It's kind of a channeled skill, making it less effective because you can't really sit here and pull off all these condies off of yourself. Although, not the worst thing in the world. Glyph of Elemental Harmony, not the worst one in the world as well. A big heal, but also gaining boon. So if you are struggling for might uptime and you don't want to have that good passive healing from Signet of Restoration, this could be considered. But a heal skill that has been touched on in the patch notes and I think could become meta maybe is Aquatic Stance. What this does is gives you two charges of healing. They're on a 20-second recharge. And what you do is you basically activate the stance skill, and when attacking an enemy, you'll do decent healing to yourself, but you'll be burst healing to yourself and your party. Now, this could be pretty good in some fights, like think of Gorsival, where he gets retaliation, but you want to carry on DPS. And if the Weaver activates this, this would allow you to do some big passive healing to your party group, making it quite a decent skill, especially if you are taking random traits like some of the barrier from bolstered elements. This could be quite a nice option to take. I would say have a look at this, especially after the PvE patch notes. Now for what I would consider pretty much a non-negotiable utility, Signet of Fire. We need that increased crit chance, but also the active side being able to burn is basically just extra conditioned DPS, as well as gaining fire aura. This does help us quite a lot with a lot of DPS skills. You can pretty much burn this mostly off of cooldown. Primordial Stance, what this utility does is gives a condition based on what we are atoned to. If we fully atone, it does that twice. Now, generally, you can burn one in fire at the beginning of your rotation when you do your burst, but generally, I think the best is to use this when you're Earth Fire atoned so that you can get that nice two stacks of bleeding with quite a decent duration. And coming back to pretty much your utility that you can play around with. Now, I like Glyph of Lesser Elementals. What this does is it will continue to just summon a whole bunch of elementals. You can pre-summon these in raids and you can basically get three of them pretty easily up in a raid. But you can go four if you do have Alacrity. Now, what these will do is obviously they're AI, so they are going to flail a lot place and probably be really poorly positioned and blah, blah, blah. But they'll smash the ground, do some DPS as well as stack a little bit of might. And that's kind of what I like about them, is they help just cap up might for your entire subgroup. And that makes it quite good to have, especially if you have a ton of them. Now, some utilities I personally enjoy. Signet of Earth, I do enjoy this. We're getting that four stacks of bleed as well as immobilize, which is going to help us proc our strength of stone, that extra bleeding. Meaning that this is quite strong. We also gain magnetic aura, which is a projectile reflect. This can be massive in certain fights like your Sabirs and whatnot, where you just want to deal with projectiles. As well, notice that the passive, the improved toughness, doesn't necessarily take effect. We are getting minus incoming damage, but notice when you do activate this, you will go up 180 toughness. Meaning that if you do have a fight where there is toughness-based tanking, just be aware of that. That combined with, obviously, Rock Barrier's 250 toughness, will drive you quite high in toughness. Just make sure that either you're the tank or there isn't toughness-based tanking, or communicate with the tank. Now, if you don't want to play around with the AI from Lesser Elements and you do not want to take something like Signet of the Earth and mess around with your toughness too much, using something like the Glyph of Elemental Power is quite a good option. A stun break as well, when using the skill, based on which atonement is your main atonement, you will gain 5 stacks of whatever element it was. Generally, it's preferred to use this in fire. Earth isn't the worst thing in the world, but obviously the fire damage is pretty big. So you'll get 5 stacks that will appear on you, and when you use your next 5 attacks, it will use these to do extra burning. That is quite a strong skill in general, and that way you don't have to worry about AI and funny things flying around and messing around with your toughness, making it quite a simple option. Obviously, Elementalist in general has other good utilities. Arcane Shield, having 3 basically Aegises, massive to use, especially in fights like maybe Deimos if you want to have some sort of shield attack. Your Glyph of Renewal, a nice res power. a lot of these signets, especially because we are in Earth, having some of these on an open world can be pretty massive. Having things like armored earth, barrier, stability, protection, not bad, stone resonance. What this does is it will build up periodically barrier, give you a lot of barrier, and then build back down with a stack of stability, as well as a whole bunch of conjured weapons that are incredibly strong and fun to play with. Playing around with almost all of these can be quite fun, so I highly recommend having a look at each one of them. And now for our leech utility, the pretty much main choice is Weave Self. Now this is a big part of our DPS rotation. We'll get into the rotation concept. So you can't really go away from this if you're doing high-end content. Now, if you're doing open world, it doesn't really matter. You can take anything. Tornado, Fiery Greatsword, or even if you're just lazy, you just want to put up like an elemental and just leave it there so it can do some damage or healing or whatever. Any one of these three or four can be considered in open world. But for Radiant Strikes and Fractals, Weave Self is just too strong not to have and a major part of our DPS rotation. And now onto the tough part of the guide, now onto the rotation concept. Now, with the rotation concept, I'm going to try and paraphrase a lot of information. Most of it is fairly easy to get across for newer players, but I am going to focus on newer players. If you're more advanced, have a look at what I say, and then obviously go about 40 million times higher in terms of information. But the long short of it is, now before the fight starts, you want to try and get up as many of these lesser fire elementals as you can. You'll be able to get up about 3-4 with alacrity. So if you're kind of waiting for the ready check and there's a long pause, just ask the guy to throw you some alac or whatever. But you want to try and get as many of these up as possible so that you don't have to really worry about them when the fight starts. They won't despawn in raids, which is brilliant. Now what you want to do is from either Firefire or whatever, you want to go into Airfire. This is the major starting part of our rotation to make use of our Weave Self skill. Now before we get into that, I'm going to go through the more basic loop of the rotation and then I'll come back to the starting position. So for the basic loop, what we want to do is just atone to Firefire, say for instance. Now for the general loop, what we all want to do is to be in Fire Earth or Firefire for the start of your general part of your rotation. Pretty much, depending on whether you've got the Focus or the Warhorn, your rotation will change ever so slightly. First of all, if you are using the Warhorn, Warhorn 4 is optional. This will basically just basically copy your Fury and a bit of Might, so it's quite more of a supportive skill. That means if you're playing pure DPS and you have supportive players playing, you do not need to use this skill. Everything else should pretty much be used off of cooldown, and that's going to be the main crux of the rotation. So what you are going to do is you're going to go from Firefire to Fire Earth, making obviously use of Wildfire and skill 3 Fractured Strikes and skill 2 Rock Barrier. Remember, you need to activate this and then cast it. You will have increased toughness for the duration of the skill. That is incredibly important to be aware of. You will have 250 toughness. So if there is toughness based tanking, just communicate with the tank to make sure you're not griefing with the skill. Now also something to get used to is you have a 4-second charge time in between these skills. So from obviously your earth fire, you'll go into fire with your off being earth. Now again, depending on whether you have the Warhorn or the Focus will change your rotation slightly. Obviously you want to try it in your Dragon's Tooth, your Fractured Strike if it is ready to be used. If you have the Warhorn, Dust Storm is quite a big DPS increaser. Sandsqual Warhorn 4 is a really good supportive skill. Obviously a little bit of prot, magnetic aura, i.e. projectile reflect, which is really good. But most of all, this increases all boons by 3 seconds on 5 targets, so your entire party, making this an incredibly good skill. So if you are one of those players that doesn't greed too much DPS, you can slide this in, but obviously not hitting this and rather focusing on other skills is a more DPS increasing. Then what you'll do is you'll atone Firefire and you'll basically reset the rotation. So quite simple. You're basically going to go from Firefire to Earth, to Fire, to Fire again, to Earth, to fire again. And that's pretty much what you're going to be doing, hitting all the DPS skills. Now obviously if you do have the Focus, you will use both the flame skills. So you use flame wall and Fire Shield. Just note that Fire Shield is an instant skill, so this can be cast in while using other skills. You could be using this, and don't forget to burst it again. When you activate it, you get access to Transmute Fire, which is obviously a skill with a slight bit of damage as well as a burning stack and some might. So making sure to hit Firewall and Fire Shield off of cooldown pretty much in that rotation. When you switch to Earth, obviously your rotation is going to be slightly different because there is no real DPSing skill for Magnetic Wave and for Obsidian Flesh. Magnetic Wave is obviously a projectile reflect, making it really strong in certain fights like your Sabathurs, your Slothazars, things like that, as well as Cripple for some soft CC. But what's really nice is this Obsidian Flesh. What this does is gives us 3 seconds of channeled invulnerability. This is very strong in certain fights like Veil Guardian, Deimos, things like this, where you want to have an immune to damage. This will actually negate the damage from the greens, making it ridiculously strong. So yes, an incredibly strong skill to make use of. Now again, I do highly recommend having both a Focus and a Warhorn and playing around with it, seeing what works for you. I feel like the Warhorn is slightly more supportive and a little bit more DPS, where I feel like the Focus has a few really niche abilities which can kind of come in clutch in some situations. So let's go back to the start. We are making sure that we have all of our lesser elementals and we want to be using our Fire Signet pretty much off of cooldown. I like to use Primordial Starter when I am primarily atoned into Earth, making sure that I get that really nice bleed damage, and we can pretty much use our Healing Signet whenever we want because we will retain the passive. So the only skill and the only tough part of the rotation, in my opinion, is when you enter in Weave Self. I never really explained this skill properly when we looked at Elite Utilities because I thought we would have a look at it now. What Weave Self does is when you cast this ability, you have 20 seconds and you will gain the bonuses of all of the elements you're in. So you basically collect these buffs. So what we want to do is we want to start off with our primary being attuned to air and our off attuned to fire. This will allow us to start. Now, unfortunately, this is the hard slash very fast part of the rotation. What this will do is gather these elements. Now obviously, if you look at Weave Self completely by itself, you'll see that when we attune to air, we get increased damage and movement speed. When we go to fire, we get increased condition damage, and then earth is minus incoming damage and water is boon duration and healing. So you can see that the earth and water are not really as great as obviously having the plus 10% damage from air. And bigger than that, obviously, the 20% condition damage from fire. So those are the ones we want to prioritize. Hence why we want to start off in air fire. Now we have 20 seconds to get as much utility out of the skill as possible. But if we attune to all of the elements, we will get a further 10 seconds of all of the benefits. So basically, once you've collected all the benefits, then you will have 10 seconds of all the benefits if you've attuned to every single one. Now we have to obviously add in water and air into our general rotation. The general rotation is what I kind of showed you earlier of what you're going to be doing when you don't have Weave Self, because that's kind of the highest DPS portion. So what we want to do is when using Weave Self, and I'm going to try and paint a picture of what to do, but it is quite hard, especially for newer players. I would say try get in what you can of this and then just practice it, and as you get better, you will fit in more. I cannot fit in personally what the guys from like Snow Crows and whatever's fit in. It's just my ping, my muscle memory is not good enough. So don't beat yourself over the head. Obviously, the more you play the class, the better you will get at it. But I will teach you kind of how to play this. So what we want to do is when using Weave Self, prioritize your offhand fire skills. Now, if you are using the Warhorn, Wildfire is kind of where you want to look at for that. And notice that Lightning Strike is an instant skill, so you can cast Wildfire and Lightning Strikes at the same time and it won't really affect you. So what you want to do is start off an air fire, cast Weave Self, use Wildfire, Lightning Strike, then you want to switch over to fire. Now obviously before you switch over to fire, you can obviously burst your Signet of Fire just to put it on cooldown, which is quite a good idea in general. Then once you're in fire air, if you have the Warhorn, Lightning Orb is a fair amount of damage. Then you want to try get off your Dragon's Tooth and get your first Primordial Stance on cooldown. Because remember, you have 2 charges. You can burn 1 in fire just to kind of started ticking. Your atonements are coming off cooldown every 2 seconds because of the skill rather than 4 seconds. So you will need to move fairly fast. Then what you will do is you will pure atone to fire to try get use of Phoenix. Phoenix is a massive hitting skill and probably one of the most important ones. Now you'll obviously fill in a couple of auto attacks, go into Earth Stance, and while in Earth Stance, use Rock Barrier and immediately into Hurl, as well as a Fracturing Strike. Now once you've used your Fracturing Strike, you want to go back into Fire so that you can get Dust Storm as well as Dragon Tooth, do a bit of DPS, go into pure Fire Atonement, and then basically hit whatever is off cooldown. Obviously you can ignore Warhorn 4, obviously a DPS increaser to do this, and then you want to go back to Earth. Now pretty much you'll notice that this is kind of like the normal rotation, but just at a quicker pace, because you will have 2 second atonement changes. Now when you're entering into Earth Fire, again I like to hit Primordial Stance here to rather get that extra bleed, the 2 stacks with the long duration. If your Signet of Fire is ready, use it again, because remember you did use it earlier, as well as whatever skills you can kind of get away with. Then what you'll want to do is go into Fire again, use your Dragon Tooth, and then go into Pure Fire, use whatever skills you can kind of get off, and then try get back into Earth, use Rock Barrier, burst it again for the Hurl, and then Fracturing Strikes. Now, obviously, there is a lot, and if you really do, I want to put a link to the build and Snowcross in the description below, so you can look at that exact opener. I personally do not like to memorize an opener or whatever, because it gets confusing. What I would do is start off with Air, Fire, and then go Fire, Air, Fire, Fire, Earth, Fire, Fire, Earth, Fire, Fire, and blah, blah, blah. And I would pretty much go until you start to see Weave Self start to flash. It will flash for about 3 seconds remaining on the buff itself on your toolbar, and in which case I would enter into water to make sure that I complete the rotation. Notice that Stone Tide, your skill 3, has a massive hidden skill with 8 stacks of bleed, so an incredibly strong skill, and then just Shattering Stones. Those are kind of the two abilities you want to get in when inside of Water Earth, and that's pretty much how you want to end the rotation. Once you've done this, you will obtain Perfect Weave, meaning you'll get an extra 10 seconds, and then when you exit, you want to basically just go for Fire, and then you can pretty much ignore most of these things. You can obviously hit Fiery Frost if you want to for an extra fire stack. Not the worst thing in the world. You can ignore these skills if you don't need them. And then pretty much start the rotation over again from Fire Fire. Now obviously, if I could give you a piece of advice as a newer player, what I would suggest with Weave Self is pick 2 skills, hit them, and then switch. Do not delay your switching of elements. Go through as many as possible. Go, you know, as many through the Fire, Earth, Fire, Fire atonements as you can. When you see this blinking, go to water, regardless of whatever element you're currently in, whether it's Fire or Earth, it doesn't really matter. Obviously, it is nice if you have Earth and you switch over to water to get this Stone Tide. It is quite a large hidden skill, but do not stress. Having the Perfect Weave itself is more than enough DPS for when you go into water. So then switching out of water as quickly as you can again, just using some Dragon Tooth and auto attacks. Also, another thing I would like to just mention is most of these skills have got significant range. Make sure that you're always DPSing. Even if you're doing split phases or moving away from mechanics, face the boss, make sure that you're always auto attacking and doing as much DPS as possible. If you do struggle with the timing of lesser elements like I always do, do consider some of the other good options for DPS. Remember also, this elemental power is a fairly easy skill to use. You just basically plonk it on, it's going to give you the stacks and then just DPS, which is sometimes easier for some players, especially like myself, to get used to the timing of when to be hitting these buttons. And again, I just like to say that this class is incredibly strong. Don't also forget about some of the supportive skills, especially like Warhorn 4 in your Fire and your Earth Atonement. Incredibly strong supportive skills to be using. Don't forget about your projectile reflex that you've got, and also have a look at some of your CC abilities. You've got obviously Stone Air, you've got Earthen Synergy, this is a 150 Defiance Break Bar. You've got Warhorn 4, Cyclone at 150 Defiance Break Bar. You've got Water 4, your Tidal Surge. And then obviously if you are taking the Focus 5, Gale, an incredibly strong 400 Defiance Break Bar. And you have a Focus 5 in Water, Comet, a nice 200 Defiance Break Bar. Just being aware of where your CC skills are, so that in a fight you can try and plan your rotation to use them. Obviously going inside of water and air is a big DPS loss outside of self-weave. Just make sure that you're pre-planning your rotation accordingly. Sometimes not doing CC can be a bigger DPS because usually that leads to a wipe or just a boss having reduced damage taken. And that's the video. Thank you so much for watching. If you liked the video, please give it a like and a subscribe. That makes a massive difference for my channel as well. Don't forget to check out my Twitch. Would love to see you hang out there. You know, maybe I'm doing some drops, always worth a check out. And if you didn't enjoy the video, thank you so much for watching anyway, and I'll hopefully see you guys in the next one. Cheers.